If there's one thing that you should know about everything is that it is better as a competition. Let's talk about competitive programming. Competitive programming has been a semi-popular topic that has been requested ever since I mentioned OSU that one time. Being a programmer though, I haven't partaken in competitive programming in 2 years, and so I don't consider myself to be particularly qualified to cover this topic, but that's what YouTube is all about. And so, if you are good at competitive programming, I have nothing more to say. Competitive programming is different from the programming done in software engineering. It is technically a sport, and so unlike in software engineering, there is a way to win. Programs are made to solve very specific or niche problems with a text input and an expected text output in which the format has to be very exact. For the problem A plus B, the automatic judge inputs A and B, and the program is expected to output A plus B. The test cases could result in a number of statuses. There is WA, which is the sound you make when you fail, and AC, which stands for accepted. There's also time limit, memory limit, what are you doing, etc. This verdict is determined by an online judge, and one of the most popular online judges is the Russian website Codeforces. Now the first step is to use a VPN to change my location to the Netherlands. This is not a sponsorship, I am simply IP banned from what I believe to be accidental server abuse. And then we can select a random problem statement out of the variety of statements under Codeforces problem set to get started. Another online judge that exists is called DMOJ, which stands for DMOJ, Modern Online Judge. From here, you can already start to see differences in different online judges. Codeforces allows you to submit code in its editor or as a file, whereas DMOJ only allows you to submit code in its editor or Minecraft server. Let's look at the single source shortest path problem. The problem statement is solve the single source shortest path problem. Basically, given this network of roads and you're at one point, what is the shortest distance possible to get to every other point? In the example, the road between points 1 and 2 has a distance of 2, and so logically the distance between points 1 and 2 is 2. The road between points 1 and 3 has a distance of 5, but you can get there faster by going from 1 to 2 to 3 at a total distance of 2 plus 2 equals 4. Thus, the distance from 1 to 3 is 4. As for point 4, we can recognize that it is impossible, and therefore give up. The problem statement tells us to put the distance as negative 1 in this case, because it is impossible to have a distance of negative 1, just like the impossible pursuit of getting to point 4. This entire process is achieved using Dijkstra's algorithm, which is most of Edsger Dijkstra's legacy. This is a man who lived a human life, just like you. At one point in that human life, he thought to himself, how can I get from Rotterdam to the other city in the Netherlands? After thinking for 20 minutes, he came to the conclusion that you can get there by going to places that are not there until you get there.
This is not the Netherlands. This is not the Netherlands.
Going to other places doesn't mean going to every other place, though. Intuitively, the further you've gone, the less likely you're on the shortest path, especially as you get really far away. Thus, it makes sense to go to places in order of how far away they are to slowly traverse towards your destination. Say we have the option to either go to Amsterdam or Utrecht from Rotterdam. The distance from Rotterdam to Amsterdam is about 65 kilometers, whereas the distance from Rotterdam to Utrecht is 55 kilometers. Therefore, we can queue up a move from Rotterdam to Utrecht with a total distance traversed of 55 kilometers. Now, the distance from Utrecht to Amsterdam is about 40 kilometers. However, the number we're concerned with is not the distance up ahead, but with the total distance traversed thus far. Since Rotterdam to Utrecht was 55 kilometers, Rotterdam to Utrecht to Amsterdam would give us 55 plus 40 kilometers of a total of 95 kilometers, which is more than the 65. And so our next move queued is actually Rotterdam to Amsterdam. Of course, this algorithm is assuming that Dutch computer scientists can teleport to anywhere that they've been before. From Amsterdam, we can then go to Utrecht. However, we already know that it is possible to get to Utrecht in 55 kilometers, and to get from Amsterdam to Utrecht is another 40 kilometers on top of the 65 kilometers, giving giving us a total of 105 kilometers, which is longer than the 55, and so we don't do that. Despite there being multiple ways to get to both of these cities, we have the shortest distances to both Utrecht and Amsterdam. Notice that this worked out because we're keeping track of the shortest distance to each city so far, terminating any paths that increase the distance for any city. Notice that this prevents any cycles from happening as well. You wouldn't go from Rotterdam to Amsterdam back to Rotterdam, for example, because the distance from Rotterdam to Rotterdam is zero, which will always be less than the distance taken going back and forth. Now let's say we either have the option to go from Amsterdam to Groningen, our final destination, Utrecht to Groningen, or Amsterdam to Birmingham. The distance from Amsterdam to Groningen is 180 kilometers. The distance from Utrecht to Groningen is also 180 kilometers. The distance from Amsterdam to Birmingham is approximately 600 kilometers. It's apparent that the shortest path from Rotterdam is Utrecht to Groningen, giving us 55 kilometers plus 180 kilometers, or a total of 235 kilometers. We have thus calculated that it is possible to get from Rotterdam to Groningen in 235 kilometers. Well, what about the other paths? Well, since we're going in order of shortest path from Rotterdam, once we've reached Groningen, any other paths that could eventually lead to Groningen will have to be equal to or greater than 235 kilometers, and so we do not care. There is no reason to go to Birmingham, and also it is superfluous to traverse there in the scope of this example. Dijkstra's algorithm is not a difficult algorithm. It's maybe the second algorithm you learn in algorithm class after Dijkstra, but easier. The implementation is very boring. This is an adjacency matrix, which is a 2D array that holds the distance of the shortest road or edge between any two cities or nodes. This is the distance array, which holds the shortest distance so far for every node and changes as the algorithm executes. This is a priority queue, which is a queue that sorts itself whenever you put something into the queue, such as paths, which can be sorted by distance, and this is Ray Evangelion if she was a fast food employee. Putting it all together, you just take your node along with its total path distance from your queue, check it with your currently stored distance of that node, and then enqueue all of its neighboring nodes, repeating this process until you get to the destination. If there isn't a specific destination in place, then just go everywhere and keep it running until you've run out of places to go and things to make better. This is a metaphor for life, but more relevantly for the DMOJ problem. What we're left with is a set of nodes that all have their shortest distances, which is exactly what the problem is looking for. Congratulations, you are now capable of solving this one specific problem on DMOJ, which places you in the top 30% of DMOJ users. But not every problem is single source shortest path. What if the problem was bubble sort? Or sieve of Eratosthenes, Ford Fulkerson, segment tree, Aho Karasik, Robin Karp, link cut tree, Mo, Pollard's row, parallel nightmare, Dinix, Fecto L. Phyllis, suffix automata, Fecto Forgo, slice and splice, Zan Partisan, Russian peasant, Brims and Cruzcoles, suffix automata 2, Zero, Z, Captain Vull, Convex Hull, Baron Gallic, Gramscan, Stable Marriage, King DDD. This is a list of Kirby antagonists, actually. Indeed, a lot of competitive programming is just memorizing algorithms and their template implementations. You may find yourself memorizing sweep line algorithm, which has a use. Where competitive programming gets less uninteresting is when we deviate from the templates. Let's look at the Vim7 Wook 15 number 4 gold chain rule. The problem statement is to solve Vim7 Wook 15 number 4 gold chain rule. Basically, you once again have a network of nodes and roads with a start point and end point and a secret surprise middle point. The secret surprise is that you have to go there as well, at some point between the start and the end. However, we don't actually know this middle point. All we know is the start and the end, and so the problem requires us to assume that the middle point is at whichever point that will maximize the shortest path from the start to the middle to the end, meaning that we have to find the longest shortest path distance. Also, this time, all the nodes are guaranteed to be connected. This is obviously a Dijkstra problem, and even if it wasn't, you wouldn't know, would you? We can recall from template Dijkstra that it is quite easy to get a distance from the start to the end. However, this does not guarantee that we go out of our way to the furthest middle node. In fact, it probably wouldn't in the shortest path. Not knowing the furthest middle node also means that we can't just run Dijkstra from the start to the middle and then the middle to the end, unless we run Dijkstra for every single node and compare which one's the furthest, in which case we'll probably exceed the time limit. It is here that we must truly understand the Dijkstra algorithm in that it's not an algorithm to compute a distance between an inherent start and an inherent end, but rather the distance array of any singular node to every other node. This means that the start of your Dijkstra algorithm can actually be the end of your problem. The total distance can be split into two parts, from the start to the middle and the middle to the end, which, on a bidirectional graph, is equivalent to the start to the middle plus the end to the middle. We thus only need to run Dijkstra twice, once on the start node and once on the end node. Summing up the two resulting distance arrays, we get the shortest distance needed to get from the start to the end while passing through any singular node. The longest distance in this new distance array thus represents the shortest distance needed to get from the start to the end while passing through the furthest middle node. Such distance being, of course, the expected output of our solution. The solution to a problem which, from such a perspective, only deviates slightly from the template. The sport of competitive programming ultimately relies on both an understanding of theoretical concepts and of the implementations of data structures. I wouldn't consider myself to be particularly athletic, and in my opinion, most of competitive programming is about as relevant to software engineering as chess, though it's also as interesting and logically challenging. Even if it's been a few years though, it always feels at home to be accepted by the server of an online judge website.